Congressman, one of the most memorable moments of the 2008 campaign, I think, was your clash, I guess, at the debate with Rudy Giuliani over maybe the cause of 9/11. As we approach the 10-year anniversary of 9/11, what does it mean to you, and do you think, and how do you think that the American people are seeing it, and what vantage point do you see the American people viewing 9/11 10 years later?
Well, I'm saddened by it all because we haven't changed anything, and we've made things much worse. For instance, suicide terrorism is one of the greatest threat we have. People who want to commit these kind of acts, it's so difficult to defend ourselves against. But, you know, before we invaded Iraq for the wrong reason, there was no al-Qaeda there, had nothing to do with 9/11. But before we invaded Iraq, the Iraqis had never committed any acts of suicide terrorism. By 2007, they were committing over 300 acts of terrorism against Americans or allies of Americans. So suicide terrorism, our greatest threat, is directly related to our presence in Arab countries and propping up puppet governments in that region. And there's been total denial of this. They won't pay any attention. So we're not safer. We're more broke than ever. And the evidence is out there to explain exactly the direct correlation between our presence over there and the dangers we face.
Email from Christopher in Fort Bragg, North Carolina. I understand and agree with most of your positions on issues currently concerning the people of the United States. An issue I have not heard you talk about much, and which I also didn't see on your website, is the environment. I believe certain environmental issues require governmental oversight. Things like water sources and federally protected land can be misused and abused if each state is left to fend for itself and regulate itself. What's your stand on the environment? How do you recommend we protect things like water tables and shared water sources, such as the Great Lakes?
Well, I think it's an important question because I have written somewhat about this. I don't probably talk about it as much as I should. But my contention is that during the Industrial Revolution, big government and big corporations became pretty good buddies, and they quite freely polluted our air and our water. I was raised in the city of Pittsburgh. Our rivers were sewers, and our skies were not much better. They were essentially cleaned up with local city ordinances long time before the EPA. But this could be managed in a free market society if you have strict respect for private property. Because if you and I have property next to each other, neither of us have a right to pollute your air or your water. So property rights are very, very important. Even when it comes to water, in Texas they've developed pretty clearly the property rights of oil. So people can't drill oil next to your farm and suck out all the oil under your land because it's your property. And the laws are written pretty good for that. So property rights can do this. And the basic principle that you cannot pollute your neighbor's property is a pretty good one. But I think there are times when you do need to government to enforce those laws. The more local, the better. But there will be times when the federal government has to be involved because, our air goes across state boundaries. Water goes from one state to another. So under those circumstances, I think that we should have the federal government involved.
Presidential candidate Ron Paul, the political junkie Ken Rudin is with us. You're listening to Talk of the Nation from NPR News. And let's go next to John. John with us from Alexandria, Virginia.
Hi, Congressman. I'm calling because I'm an entrepreneur. I run my own business, and I love doing that. But one of the concerns that I have is that it seems like a lot of the discussion in Washington focuses on what's best for big businesses. And, you know, there's talk about people who make lots of money as job creators. But a lot of the proposals that are out there to do anything from changing the tax code to altering Social Security so that you can invest in big businesses don't necessarily affect me. So I wanted to know, what would you think that you could do and what the federal government should do for people like me? And would you be willing to take that to your competitors during the debates and challenge them to make changes to the tax code and to entitlements that don't just benefit the biggest out there, but also benefit those who are seeking to innovate on their own?
Yeah, I think you're right about that. I think the system in D.C. is very much controlled by big banks and big corporations, the military-industrial complex, giant farms that get their subsidies. So they have lobbyists, and they get their tax codes and the regulatory system benefiting them. Very often, corporations come to Washington for regulation because they know if you're a small businessman, you don't have the same ability to get around the system and have the tax, you know, your tax attorneys and different attorneys. But in talking about subsidies, though, I don't want any subsidies, so I don't want to give them to the big guys to take an advantage of the smaller people. And I want the regulations to be the same way. They should not, we should not allow the big companies to dictate, regulations. For instance, on both the Democrats and the Republicans, when they have medical care reforms, they protect drug companies and the insurance companies. And that shouldn't be so. Everybody should be protected equally. Nobody should get any special privileges. Everybody should obey the rules of contracts and private property rights.
John, thanks very much for the call.
Thank you.
And we just have a minute or so left with you, Congressman, but I wanted to ask, your supporters claim that we in the media don't take you seriously enough. You're dismissed as a second-tier candidate. What do you have to do to be taken seriously as a first-tier candidate? Where are you going to go and win something?
Mm-hmm. Well, there'll be plenty of chances pretty soon. We do, you know, pretty darn well in all the straw votes, which proves that we have support, we can raise money, we can organize, and people are energized. But the numbers still have to come out in elections, which probably will, the real test will be in January. But from our inside, campaign organization, we do know that it's easier to raise money. The volunteers are more than ever. The country has shifted. Attitudes have changed. The majority of the American people don't like the war, and they're looking at the monetary system.
Well, Congressman Paul, good luck to you on your campaign, and thanks very much for being with us again on Talk of the Nation.
Thank you.
Ron Paul, who represents the 14th District of Texas, he's already announced he will not be running for re-election to focus on the presidential campaign. And, Ken Rudin, is he going to be accepted as a first-tier candidate?
Well, compared to 2008, he certainly is. The question is whether the party has moved so far to him or whether he's shifted with the times. But he's certainly more going to be a much more prominent force than he was in 2008.
Political junkie Ken Rudin joins us every Wednesday. Next Tuesday, his column comes back at npr.org/junkie. And, well, that scuttlebutt and puzzle, too. And he'll be back here next Wednesday. But coming up, the dreaded high school reunion. It took Clarence Page 20 years to work up the nerve to go. Now he says they're therapeutic. He joins us next. Stay with us. I'm Neil Conan. It's the Talk of the Nation from NPR News.